Hello and welcome. This is part two of our video about quality assurance and improvement program. In the previous video, we had an overview of the mandatory requirements of the standards regarding the quality assurance and improvement program. We discussed the internal assessment and what are the constituents of internal assessment. In this video, we'll move forward and we'll understand the mandatory requirements of external assessment. As we know that Chief Audit Executive is responsible for internal assessment as well as external assessment. Standard 1312 gives us information about the external assessment. What is the purpose of external assessment? The purpose is to validate whether the internal audit activity conforms with the standards and whether the internal auditors apply the code of ethics. As per mandatory guidance of IIA given in standard 1312, the external assessment must be conducted at least once every 5 years by a qualified independent assessor or assessment team from outside the organization. So, as per interpretation, the external assessment may be accomplished either by full external assessment or a self-assessment with independent external validation. As per implementation guide, the self-assessment may be performed in lieu of all a full external assessment, provided it is validated by a qualified, independent, competent and professional external assessor. In such cases, the scope of the self-assessment with external independent validation would consist of a comprehensive and fully documented self-assessment process that emulates the full external process and an independent on-site validation by a qualified independent assessor. This is normally not advisable as per my experience that your first external assessment will be an external validation. It is better to have a full-fledged external assessment when you are having your first external assessment. Then maybe subsequently you might develop a structure on the basis of those results, an internal self-assessment followed by an external validation. So this is what we can follow in for our external assessments. So, as per standard 1312, the Chief Audit Executive must discuss with the board the form and frequency of the external assessment and the qualification and independence of the external assessor or assessment team, including any potential conflict of interest. So now we know the frequency of external assessment, which is 5 years, a minimum requirement. An organization may have a lesser frequency, it's your option, it's a choice. Also, while hiring an assessor, the chief audit executive needs to ensure that the assessor is qualified to conduct this assessment. As we know, we discussed in 1311 internal assessment, the sufficient knowledge, which means understanding of all elements of the IPPF. So similarly, we need to ensure that the external assessor is having the required knowledge. Also, independence is always prime importance from internal audit perspective, because to get an objective report of the external assessor, you need to see that the independence is not impaired, and if there is any current or perceived conflict of interest exist, then the same should be disclosed. So let's discuss about report of the external assessor. The external assessor, as per the interpretation of the standards, must conclude as to conformance with the code of ethics and the standards. The external assessor may also include the operational or strategic comments. Also, regarding the rating, the external assessor can give a rating, and there is an example given also that he needs to identify that the internal audit activity is generally conforming or partially conforming or does not conform to the IPPF and the requirements of IIA. So when we talk about the discussion of chief audit executive with the board or audit committee, the chief audit executive needs to keep conformance evidence for this. So as per my own experience and to show the evidence of conformance, I recommend that chief audit executive should maintain minutes of the meetings with the board, whether these are separate meetings with the individual directors or a comprehensive meeting with the board, or maybe there are meetings with the senior management, having the discussion on of the form and frequency of the external assessor. Also, the discussions on the qualifications and independence of the external assessor. These should be clearly, promptly documented in the minutes of the meeting. It is also advisable to keep the agenda documents, because minutes are having the conclusion of the discussions and a summary of that, but what agenda has been presented to the board, it's better to keep that document as an evidence where maybe a conflict of interest or potential conflict of interest is shared with the board, or it is shared with the board that there is no conflict of interest exists. So I think this will provide sufficient appropriate conformance evidence with the chief audit executive that they have discussed with the board the form and frequency of the external assessment and the qualifications of the and the independence of external assessor. What is a qualified assessor or assessment team? Is the one who demonstrates competence in two areas: in the professional practice of internal auditing and in the external assessment process. Competence can be demonstrated through a mixture of experience and theoretical learning, experience gained in the organizations of similar size, similar sector, similar complexity is always valuable and more relevant than the less experience of the industry. In case of assessment team, not all the members need to have all the collective competencies, but as a team, collectively they need to have the required competencies. It is actually up to the professional judgment of chief audit executive how he assesses the team's capability and competence to conduct a successful external assessment. Independent assessor. an independent assessor or assessment team means not having either an actual or perceived conflict of interest and not being part of or under the control of the organization to which the internal audit activity belongs. The chief audit executive should encourage board oversight in the external assessment to reduce the perceived or potential conflict of interest. Standard 1320. So, as per Standard 1320, the chief audit executive must communicate the results of the quality assurance and improvement program to the senior management and the board. What does it mean? The chief audit executive is not having a choice here. He cannot be selective. He needs to share whether the results are good or bad. He must have to share these reports and these results with the senior management and the board. The form, content and frequency of communicating the results of quality assurance and improvement program is established through discussion with the board, like how they want the reporting of this and considering the responsibilities of the internal audit activity. As per Standard 1320, the chief audit executive must communicate the results to the senior management and board, and that communication should include the scope and frequency of both internal and external assessments, the qualification and independence of the assessors or assessment team, the conclusion of the assessors, any corrective action plans that have been created from the assessments to address areas that were not in conformance with the standards, along with the opportunities for improvements. So, let's answer some basic questions here. Why are the results communicated to the senior management and board? This is to demonstrate conformance with the standards and the code of ethics. When are the results of external and internal assessments or periodical assessments communicated? Not the whole internal assessment, we are not talking about the ongoing monitoring, but the periodical internal assessment or external assessment. So, when the results are communicated, this is upon completion of such assessments, the results should be communicated. When are the results of ongoing monitoring are communicated? These results should be communicated on annual basis. And it is needless to repeat here that the results include the assessors or assessment team's evaluation with respect to the degree of conformance. So, what is the proper use of conformance statement? And when it is appropriate to indicate that the internal audit activity is conforming with the standards? As per standard, indicating that the internal audit activity conforms with international standards for professional practice of internal auditing is appropriate only if it is supported by the results of the quality assurance and improvement program. And we know quality assurance and improvement program means the internal and external assessments both. So, when we say that the internal audit activity conforms with the standards and code of ethics, it means that the internal audit activity conforms when it achieves the outcomes described therein. Like all internal audit activities will have the results of internal assessments, but those activities which has a time span of at least 5 years should be having also external assessments. standard 1322. It's about disclosure of non-conformance. When non-conformance with the code of ethics and standards impacts the overall scope or operation of internal audit activity, the chief audit executive must disclose the non-conformance and the impact thereof to the senior management and the board. And I suppose it is needless to clarify here that when we say non-conformance with the code and the standards, it means that it has an impact on the overall scope and operation of the internal audit activity. So let's just see now what are the relevant performance standards relevant to the quality assurance improvement program. Standard 2070, this is regarding external service providers or outsourcing of the internal audit function, and 2430 is use of conducted in conformance with the standards. So using of these wordings at the engagement level. Standard 2070, which is regarding the external service provider and organizational responsibility for internal auditing. So this standard requires that when an ESP or external service provider serves as the internal audit activity, the provider must make the organization aware that the organization has the responsibility for maintaining an effective internal audit activity. They cannot transfer the buck. The interpretation of this is given by the standards that the responsibility is demonstrated by the management through the quality assurance and improvement program, which assesses conformance with the code of ethics and the standards. The second performance standard 2430, which is regarding usage of the wording of conducted in conformance with the standard. It is only, it is indicated in the engagements, it can be indicated in the engagements and is appropriate to indicate in the engagement only if it is supported by the results of the quality assurance and improvement program. How to update quality assurance and improvement program? As per implementation guide, the chief audit executive periodically evaluates the quality assurance and improvement program and updates it as needed. For example, by the time the internal audit activities they become mature, they as the conditions of the internal audit activity change, maybe organizational structure changes, there are adjustments needed in the quality assurance and improvement program and become necessary, and they may become necessary to ensure that it continues to operate in an efficient and effective manner. So that review periodically has to be done by the chief audit executive. Why this is needed? This is needed to assure the stakeholders that the internal audit activity is adding value to the organization and is not actually stay put on their improvement in innovation area. So they need to keep improving and learning, and that is through in a well established current quality assurance and improvement program. And we know that adding value is our mission as an internal auditor as per our definition. So for standard 1300 and the other relevant standards, how we need to keep the conformance evidence? We'll get help from the implementation guide on this and list down simply those areas which or documents we need to keep as a conformance evidence of the implementation of quality assurance and improvement program. So first and the most important is documented quality assurance and improvement program. Then the results of your internal assessment, external assessments, their reports, communication of the results with the board. This should include findings, corrective action plans, corrective actions taken, as well as documentation of the actions taken to improve the internal audit activities efficiency and effectiveness. Like we learned earlier that the areas of improvement is also the second part of those reports. For external assessment, we need to keep the documentation from external assessor and the written independent validation. Minutes of the meetings, very important. The agenda of the documents, we discussed this before. Benchmarking report and the request for services to show due diligence in vetting external assessors. So that is, again, we need to see that the external assessor is has been checked properly before they started their external assessment. We need to see and keep the documentation of KPI monitoring. We need to see the performance evaluation. These are more relevant to the performance standard. Personal development plans, engagement work papers, test reports, including minutes of opening meetings, closing meetings, audit reports, engagement review notes, technical linguistic reviews, review notes, etc., etc., and the periodical assessment. For periodical assessment, you need to have the scope of review, maybe engagement letters, approach, what approach or methodology has been adopted, working papers and communication reports. So, concluding all this, thanks for being part of this important subject, Quality Assurance and Improvement Program. We have two videos. We learned overall the standard 1300 and all the relevant standards. We knew what is the mandatory requirements regarding the internal assessments, external assessments, what is a qualified assessor, what is an independent assessor, how to report non-conformance, when and how to use the conformance wording. So we have, and what evidence should be kept for to show the conformance of implementation of Quality Assurance and Improvement Program. So thank you so much for being part of this interesting topic. It's a very wide subject. It does not look that much, but it is having further details. It's very comprehensive when you conduct it actually, because all standards come into play when we are conducting an external assessment. So thank you so much, and we will keep having discussion on these topics and further standards on the upcoming videos. Keep liking my channel and please do subscribe.